Macmillan Audio presents American Gun, the true story of the AR-15 by Cameron McWhirter and Zusha Elinson. Read for you by Roger Wayne. When you see something that is technically sweet, you go ahead and do it, and you argue about what to do about it only after you have had your technical success. J. Robert Oppenheimer, who led the effort to make the first atomic bomb. Guns, like everything else, have their social history. John Ellis, The Social History of the Machine Gun. A note about names. The AR-15. Over the decades, various individuals, companies, and government entities have given the AR-15 rifle different names, and following the many labels can get confusing. For this book, we have tried to streamline nomenclature while remaining historically accurate. The AR-15 rifle was the 15th weapon developed by Armalite, a subsidiary of Fairchild Engine and Airplane Corporation. AR-15 stood for the name of the company and a model number. Once the military adopted the gun, it assigned the rifle the designation M16 for its 16th model of an infantry rifle. Military bureaucracy assigned various designations to different versions of the gun, including XM16E1, an early adopted version, and later M16A1. Various versions followed, all with updates, but the guns were fundamentally versions of the AR-15 invented by Eugene Stoner and his colleagues at Armalite that permitted automatic as well as semi-automatic firing. Commercial versions of the gun, which were limited to semi-automatic fire, were commonly called AR-15s. In the interest of clarity, we will refer to Eugene Stoner's rifle prior to its military adoption as the AR-15. In discussing military versions of the rifle, we use the designation M16, unless referring to later variants such as the M4. We have not altered quotes in which officials may have referred to the AR-15 when discussing the military version of the gun. We will call the civilian version of the rifle the AR-15 instead of the oft-used journalistic phrase AR-15-style rifle, for simplicity's sake. Proper military usage regarding rifle designation has no hyphen between the M and the model number. For example, M16 as opposed to M-16. However, the two versions often have been used interchangeably in official reports, private correspondence, academic papers, books, newspaper accounts, and various other records from the 1960s to the present day. In the interest of uniformity, we have corrected all references to M-16 to read M16. Colt. The gunmaker Colt purchased the manufacturing rights to the AR-15 from Armalite's parent company, Fairchild Engine and Airplane Corporation, in 1959. Colt used different names over the decades, including in the 1950s, Colts. To reduce confusion, we have simply referred to the company in this book as Colt. Automatic, semi-automatic, select fire. An automatic rifle allows the shooter to fire a stream of bullets by holding down the trigger. A semi-automatic rifle allows the shooter to fire one shot per trigger pull. The gun automatically loads the next round using the energy from the previous shot. All the shooter has to do is pull the trigger. The distinction is important in the story of the AR-15. The military version of the gun, the M16, was designed so that soldiers could fire it on full automatic or semi-automatic with the flip of a switch. This type of gun is called select fire. The AR-15s sold to civilians on the commercial market are semi-automatic. Bullets, cartridges, rounds, and caliber. A bullet is a metal projectile that flies out of the barrel of a gun. A cartridge, also known as a round, is made up of the bullet and a metal casing that contains propellant. A bullet's caliber is generally a measurement of its diameter. The AR-15 rifle uses a relatively small round that is called a .223, though it actually measures 0.224 inches, or a 5.56 round in metric nomenclature. The 5.56 round, developed for adoption by forces of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, is loaded at a higher pressure than a .223 round. Eugene Stoner filed for a patent in 1956 that would change firearms history and American culture. These diagrams, included with his patent, show his revolutionary gas system. Using this gas system in combination with modern materials like aluminum and plastic and other design features, Stoner created his most famous invention, the AR-15. The lightweight, rapid-fire rifle was easy to shoot and keep on target. It was used by U.S. soldiers to fight America's wars from Vietnam to Afghanistan. But a civilian version of the rifle later became an attractive weapon for mass shooters to attack fellow Americans. Stoner's patented gas-operated bolt and carrier system allowed him to use lightweight gas instead of the heavy metal parts long used in the internal operating systems of semi-automatic and automatic rifles. Stoner made a thin tube that channeled the gas from each shot into the heart of the gun to move mechanisms that ejected spent casings and loaded new rounds. Some gunsmiths compare the gas operation to blowing a paper wrapper off a straw. Prologue. 10 minutes, 1,057 bullets. He wandered the windowless casino floor from about 3:30 to 7:30 that morning, stopping to play video poker, his favorite game. The 64-year-old was a hunched 6 feet, pudgy and balding with sunken brown eyes and a spotty growth of white whiskers, a pasty, sullen man, more comfortable with statistical probabilities than with people. He didn't stand out on that Sunday, October 1, 2017. It wasn't strange to see a disheveled man shuffling alone past rows of the bright baby blue, ruby pink, and neon green machines that produced a cacophony of pings, bings, and cha-chings. This was Vegas, and he was just another lost soul. Video poker was his game because he felt he had mastered the machines. Stephen Paddock believed he was better than other video poker players because he had studied the probabilities of winning and losing. That morning, he played out of habit. He no longer cared whether he won. It didn't matter anymore. Paddock returned to his suite in the Mandalay Bay Hotel. Elevators carried him 32 floors above the city. The upper floor suites commanded grand views, from the south end of the famous strip out to the desert mountains ringing the city. Paddock's multiple rooms, called a Vista Suite by the hotel, looked down on Las Vegas Boulevard and beyond to the black glass pyramid of the Luxor Hotel and Casino. Across the boulevard's 6 lanes was a large venue for concerts and festivals called Las Vegas Village. For days, Paddock had driven his black 2017 Chrysler Pacifica minivan back and forth between his home in nearby Mesquite, Nevada, and the Mandalay Bay. Each time, he had brought more suitcases and bags. Sometimes bellboys helped him, wheeling carts stacked with his bags to the larger service elevators. They chatted and laughed, and Paddock tipped them. Early in the afternoon on October 1, Paddock brought 2 rolling suitcases and a bag to his suite, riding in an elevator alone. He called for room service, then set up a small video camera on a room service cart out in the hallway to monitor any movement from a laptop in his suite. He used power tools to install a metal bracket that blocked the stairwell door in the hallway. He had a hammer to break window glass when the time came. He brought a scuba mask to help him deal with the smoke or tear gas when police responded. Paddock unzipped his bags and took out 14 AR-15 semi-automatic rifles and 8 similar guns called AR-10s. He had dozens of fully loaded 100-round magazines. The rifles were civilian versions of guns invented in the 1950s by a tiny company in Hollywood, California. The company created a revolutionary rifle for the U.S. military. It was a light, easy-to-use weapon to help soldiers fight communist insurgencies in the developing world. The futuristic rifles were designed to achieve a simple goal: fire a lot of bullets fast to kill or maim as many enemy soldiers as possible. The design was shaped by a military adage: whoever shoots the most lead wins. By nighttime, Paddock arrayed the guns so we could pick them up in succession from the beds and the purple and white furniture near 2 floor-to-ceiling windows. To most of the rifles, he attached bump stocks, devices allowing the semi-automatic guns to mimic automatic fire. Down below, a country music festival was taking place at Las Vegas Village. About 22,000 people crowded before a large stage to hear the musician Jason Aldean. Paddock likely couldn't hear it. He'd stuffed tissue in his ears to drown out the loud noises he was about to make. At 10:05 p.m., Paddock, dressed in a brown shirt and black pants, lifted an AR-15 to his shoulder. He aimed downward. Aldean was playing a slow love song called "When She Says Baby." Fans swang to the music, thought they heard fireworks far off. Then they saw people falling. Everyone started running, but no one knew where to hide. The bullets rained down in the darkness. In about 10 minutes, Paddock fired 1,057 bullets. He killed 58 people that night and wounded 413 others. Another 456 were injured trying to escape the mayhem. An aging, overweight gambler who found sex exhausting killed more people in a mass shooting than any other individual in U.S. history. The AR-15 rifles had made the ghoulish feat easy. No one could explain why he wanted to kill so many people. Not his girlfriend, not his brothers, not the Federal Bureau of Investigation. Paddock, who had become wealthy by investing in real estate, spent nearly $95,000 on guns, ammo, and accessories in the year leading up to the massacre. In addition to his semi-automatic rifles, Paddock brought along 2 other guns, but fired only one of them, a Smith & Wesson 38 revolver. He used it to shoot himself in the head. Near his body, police found a lined sheet of paper on which Paddock had scribbled calculations of how much a bullet fired from an AR-15 would drop in its arc after 500 yards. He wanted to make sure his shots would hit concertgoers. Statistical probabilities to the end. Stephen Paddock, who grew up in Los Angeles, was born in 1953. A year later, a company called Armalite, with just a handful of employees, began operations about 15 miles away in a 1-story brick building on Santa Monica Boulevard in Hollywood. The brain of this tiny outfit was Eugene Stoner, a soft-spoken, persistent, and brilliant man in his 30s. Some called him Gene, but most people, even his wife and children, called him Stoner. One of his inventions, Armalite's 15th creation, hence its designation, AR-15, would make him one of the most famous gun designers of the 20th century, perhaps any century. American Gun is the history of how a unique rifle, invented by a family man pursuing an obsessive hobby, became the most popular and divisive rifle in U.S. history. The consequences of the AR-15's creation have coursed through our society and politics for generations in ways the weapon's inventor and promoters never foresaw. The gun has been used in conflicts far beyond U.S. borders. First and foremost, when the select fire version, the M16, was carried by U.S. troops and allies in Southeast Asia. The gun has played a key role in other conflicts as well, including the troubles in Northern Ireland, the Civil War in Colombia, and the drug wars in Mexico. Terrorists, death squads, and drug traffickers continue to use the weapon with deadly effect in Latin America and elsewhere. Those important stories need to be told, but this book centers on what happened in the United States. Handguns, far more pervasive in American society, are used in the vast majority of murders and suicides. That subject deserves its own careful exploration. This book is about a rifle that has become the lightning rod for the nation's gun debate, the AR-15. How did the weapon American soldiers carried in Vietnam become best known for killing schoolchildren? American Gun is about how that happened and what we can learn from the story. Americans know the horror of where we are now, with people going about their daily lives, at school, at the movies, at the store, at a concert, and suddenly finding themselves running for their lives as a disturbed person or extremist opens fire with an AR-15. And yet few of the participants in America's perpetual gun debate have known the true, complicated history of this consequential invention. The inventor created the gun with a simple goal: build a better rifle for the U.S. military and its allies during the Cold War. He wanted to protect the country he loved. But now, his invention is more well known as a tool to kill innocent Americans. This story involves presidents from Eisenhower to Biden, bickering generals, schmoozy businessmen, exploding watermelons, a renegade spy, desperate soldiers, cop-killing gang members, bullet-riddled goats, cult leaders, partisan senators, a tap dancer turned gunmaker, a gun-obsessed hedge fund king, mercenary ad men, a brigade of lobbyists, political extremists, disturbed killers, and victims. Those who've died, and those who must spend their lives wounded and struggling. Americans no longer feel safe. Everyday activities such as going to school and clocking into work are informed by the fear of mass shootings. Kindergartners are drilled on how to avoid being shot by attackers armed with AR-15s. Companies have tightened security and beefed up mass shooter training. Jittery movie and concert goers scan for exits. Police departments from the largest cities to the smallest towns issue military-grade body armor, able to withstand the high-velocity rounds from an AR-15. Something has to change, and true change has to focus on the core issue. How do we as a society keep this weapon out of the hands of people who shouldn't have such a gun? Solutions will require trial and error efforts, patience, compromise, and abandonment of fiercely held positions. And they will require an understanding of how we got here. This is the extraordinary story of the AR-15 rifle, the American gun. Part 1. 1. The boy who liked explosions. It's amazing he didn't hurt himself or anyone else in those days. Eugene Stoner's daughter. The July 13, 1953 issue of Life magazine featured a photo essay capturing Los Angeles's extraordinary growth. It opened with a photo of tract homes and moving vans extending down a street.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.